here were nothing but props and their stories. Musical props or dancing props or comic relief.
Since the early days of the movies, the African-American community understood the potential and danger of this new media. By the 1920s, independent producers and filmmakers, both black and white, established a subculture of race movies, low-budget, all-black cast movies specifically for black audiences. Race movies were a critical and subversive way to counter mainstream misinformation. Writer-director-producer Oscar Michaud used his films to refute the glorification of the Ku Klux Klan in The Birth of a Nation. Black actor and director Spencer Williams filled his folk dramas with fantastical imagery, as well as rare and precious scenes of everyday black life in the 1940s.
Well, honey, how did you like it?
Oh, that was good.
Florida-based white filmmaker Richard Norman made movies in which racism did not exist. In the only surviving complete film from Norman Studios, the 1926 The Flying Ace, the protagonists are Army pilots returning from the First World War. But in 1926, there were no black Army pilots, as the segregated U.S. Army would not permit African Americans to serve as pilots until World War II, 15 years later. That war proved to be more than the race movie industry could handle. Not only did the allotment of film stock favor the big studios, but U.S. war rhetoric, emphasizing patriotism and brotherhood, gave the black community hope that they could finally be included in mainstream culture. Studio films began to feature popular black artists, though their performances were often edited out for segregated Southern theaters. By the 50s, the major studios had a limited roster of black leading actors. Unfortunately, this did not lead to more opportunities for black filmmakers, and black independent filmmaking didn't pick up again until the late 1960s, when the civil rights movement gave way to the angrier, more radical 1970s.
Where's Sweetback?
Where is he?
Where is he? Sweetback.
Come on, where's Sweetback?
Melvin Van Peebles' wildly successful 1971 independent film, Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song, kicked off a decade of violent, overly sexualized Hollywood copies, usually made by white filmmakers, blaxploitation. The work of black independent filmmakers like Van Peebles, Gordon Parks Jr., Bill Gunn, and Jamaa Fanaka revealed the context behind the aggression that Hollywood blaxploitation movies took for granted. African-American communities faced police violence, war, and urban poverty, and many had become disillusioned with cries for peace. When the tropes of blaxploitation wore out, Hollywood struggled to find a new context for black talent.
Well, Robert, I've played 9 crooks, 4 gang leaders, 2 dope dealers. I played a rapist twice.
Whoa.
That was fun.
Robert Townsend satirized his own experiences as a black actor in his 1987 film, Hollywood Shuffle. The riotous comedy masks a somber question. Why would he even want to participate in an industry that only knows how to dehumanize and humiliate him?
Could you tell him to be a little more,
Yeah, Bobby, I need a little more black. You know what I'm saying? Stick your ass out. Bug the eyes.
I can't do this.
This question opened up a new era of black independent filmmaking.
Graham and Hamilton, tell me you're worth a fortune.
There has been a mistake here.
Many black directors, such as Gordon Parks, Stan Lathan, and Bill Duke, found opportunities in television, specifically through the public broadcasting service's American Playhouse.
Fight for your country! Beat the Huns! Join the Illinois 8th!
Duke's The Killing Floor, about the struggle to unionize black and white Chicago workers after World War I, goes further than just retelling the events. The emotional core of the film is the division between the black workers, those who believe in dignity and brotherhood, against those who have learned to prioritize self-preservation.
You sold out, ain't you, heavy?
I ain't sold out to nobody. I just know which side my damn bread is buttered on.
Well, I'm sorry, y'all, but I didn't ride that boxcar all the way up here to be the same as I left. I was nothing when I come up here, but I ain't gonna stay nothing.
The stratification within the Black community is also at the heart of Charles Burnett's My Brother's Wedding. Pierce, played by Everett Silas, is a disgruntled pillar of a vibrant, predominantly Black Los Angeles neighborhood, a community that is both close-knit and fractured along lines of sex, age, violence, and especially class.
Tell me, they teach you how to pick cotton in charm school?
Why, no, Pierce. Charm school taught young ladies how to be ladies and how to be charming in the presence of gentlemen.
Pierce loves his people, but he finds himself unable to see eye to eye with them at the most critical moments.
Son, you got everybody upset.
Burnett is one of the most prominent of the so-called LA Rebellion, a collective of Black filmmakers anchored to UCLA's ethnocommunications program. From the late 1960s through the 80s, Burnett, Fanaka, Billy Woodbury, Haile Garima, and many more directors in the program experimented with how to create a socially conscious Black cinema tied to their community. But they didn't expect any distribution or industry recognition for their work. Just as many of the early race movies are lost or incomplete, a number of Black independent films of the 1970s and 1980s were only recently rediscovered and preserved.
That was my land. This is where I grew up. That's where my house used to be.
Director Horace Jenkins' affectionate and location-specific 1982 romance, Cane River, reveals a fascinating side of local history.
And if we wanted to deny what we were, we would have bought that painting back and destroyed it, not hanging up for all to see.
Kathleen Collins' Losing Ground made history as the first feature film directed by a Black woman to be accepted to a major film festival. Bill Gunn's Ganja and Hess was in competition at Cannes before the director's cut was lost. And none of these groundbreaking directors lived long enough to see their films enjoy the acclaim they deserve. LA Rebellion director Julie Dash changed this unfortunate trend with Daughters of the Dust in 1991.
Do you understand? Who we are? And what we have become?
The poetic film about the Gullah culture at the turn of the 20th century became the first film directed by a Black woman to achieve a theatrical release. African-American female directors continue to make waves in the 1990s, with LA Rebellion filmmaker Zainabu Irene Davis's film, Compensation, about the relationships of hearing-impaired Black women. And Cheryl Dunier's Funny, Sexy, The Watermelon Woman, which follows a queer Black woman's love life, including her love of movies.
I am a Black lesbian filmmaker who's just beginning.
Dunier's obsession with classic Hollywood and the Black talent that fell through the cracks is an essential part of her self-discovery as an independent filmmaker. The complicated relationship between Hollywood and Black independent filmmakers continues today. Many directors follow in the footsteps of the Black filmmakers before them with small, specific, socially conscious films. But now, there are more opportunities to break into the mainstream culture and change it for the better. Over the last 100 years, Black independent filmmakers differed in style, subject, and ideology. But they are united in their determination to bring more shades of Black life to the screen. These films show us how Black people have fought, dreamed, loved, and lived. And they make it clear that the story of American cinema is not complete without Black independent film.
The show will go on, and all that I have to say is, let them have it.